As a technical, I'm not going to go in the basic architecture, basic controller level, because I'm sure most of us know about it, and it would be repetitive. Hello?
No, sir, you continue, sir.
So most of us know about it, so I'm not going to get into basics of memory architecture and things like that. I'm just going to go on the recent trends and try to connect that with the case study. So that's how I have structured my entire talk. And as I told, please feel free to interrupt me anytime and we can have our discussion then and there. So guys, when it comes to Xfinito, as ma'am mentioned that I am a co-founder at Xfinito Biodesign. And here we are looking at exploring the possibilities for affordable and accessible healthcare, right? So this is my second startup, and the reason why I entered into the startup world was my mom. So my mom got ill, and when I was a student at CEG, Anna University, under Shashikla ma'am and all others present here, that's when my mom got ill, and I wanted to solve a problem for her. And thanks to the entire faculty and the university for the support, because the lab access to everything that was provided helped me to build my first product, Relieve. And technically speaking, it was a success. So I could solve the problem for my mom, which the reason why I started that startup. And at the same time, I could help another 300 people during the informal validations that we had. However, business-wise, we failed because we were like novice, and we didn't know a lot of details about how to really handle a business. We thought business as business, but startups are a little different than a normal business that happens. So that's where we failed and we had to stop. And that's when I started my PhD at IIC Bangalore, and hopefully I'm going to submit my thesis in next few months. So keeping my fingers crossed on that. So that's how the whole journey of my startup started, a startup journey started. And Xfinito is also resultant of my PhD. Because as part of my PhD, I was working on medical device innovation and trying to understand, why startups fail and how do we have a product success in healthcare domain. So that's my core domain per se. So that's how Xfinito was born as such. And what we do, I'll just quickly go through so that you get in context of our product and how it is related to our topic today. So basically at Xfinito, we are developing a product for neurodegenerative disorders. So you may know about neuropathy, you may have heard about Parkinson's, which is much more famous. So you may understand that well. So they all are the nerve disorders that we speak about. So what we are doing is we are developing a smart footwear, which has sensors and actuators embedded in it. And that helps us in doing a lot of analysis around temperature, sensory response, pronation, foot strike, etc. And the whole idea is we'll be like monitoring the progression of nerve degeneration. We aim to prevent foot ulcers and such pressure-based disorders. And at the end of the day, we would like to support interventions and therapy that are done for these kind of diseases. So that's what this footwear does. And of course, it is connected to a smartphone and other things, which I'll in next couple of slides that we are going to speak about. So that's what we are trying to build. It's an intelligent footwear, and this is not just going to do pressure and temperature, which you must have heard, but a lot more than that. I'll come on to it in a couple of minutes. And as a startup, we are a tech startup aiming to develop intelligent connected systems. And the whole idea is to provide affordable and accessible healthcare. The vision of the startup is to innovate, invent, and discover the future of global healthcare. And a mission is to solve global health problems with affordable and accessible solutions. So if you look at our journey, how we have planned in first year 0 to year 4, we would like to understand the foot well. We would like to understand how this nerve degeneration happens. And from year 5 to year 7, we would like to enter the zone of quantifying pain, which opens up a lot of new areas that we know about. So of course, to reach there, our work and our homework starts right at year 0, where we have started. And from there, we would, at the end, year 8 to year 10, we would end up looking at neuroimaging, brain mapping, and things like that. So that's how our journey is packed. right now, and as a startup, we are mostly looking at nerves to be our center focus center, because that's the underserved area, and a lot of problems happen due to nerves, and disabilities do occur through it. So that's about my startup in a nutshell. So now getting into our core topic about medical IoT systems design. And the reason why I told this, as I told you, I'm going to connect a lot of it from the product that we are developing, so that it becomes much more easier for me to explain, and you may have a good idea about the application as well. So any system architecture, how much ever complicated we do, can be divided into three parts, right? Input, process, output. And unfortunately, in today's day, that's what most of the students don't understand, actually. So when they look at system architecture, they look at kind of having a complex system in place rather than simplifying it so that the development becomes easier. But however, as a believer of agile systems, I always think that we need to divide our systems so that we can easily look at how it is going to do and how it is going to perform and how the actions take place. So that's the reason why I've divided into three parts: input, process, and output. And that's the exact thing how I'm going to speak today about, even in the case of medical IoT. And to be frank, what is medical IoT? I just want to go about it for 2-3 minutes. So we all know about Internet of Things. So things is your any device which can be connected to internet, and your IoT basically collects all the data, and there is a whole information processing happening onto a cloud or a remote system. So that's what is IoT. But in case of medical IoT, why it is so different? There are two reasons over here. Because one, of course, medical deals with rough sensitive healthcare data. That's of course one, but second and the most important things are the regulations. So regulations is where the entire IoT system changes. So if you look at normal IoT devices, it would talk about FCC, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, Zigbee, LoRa. So all those things are protocols and regulations as well. So each of this has a regulatory aspect, whatever communication channel that you use. And apart from that, there would be some focus on safety. However, when it comes to medical, there are a lot more coming into picture. It would start from EMI, EMC, and the way that works with the body. That's one. Then I'll take some of the basics in the last slide, I guess. And of course, apart from that, your safety and efficacy standards that a regular medical device follows. Finally, cybersecurity and AI is something that's coming up new and we need to be aware of. So our system architecture has to focus right in the first stage on how do we handle these, because these requirements is going to define your system, right? All your input, process, output will be defined by these regulatory requirements. So you need to look at it from the start. However, to keep it simple, I'll first go to the normal and then specifically look at all these aspects later. So first, getting into input. So input, of course, we can look at inputs based on sensors. I'm sure yesterday, I guess it was all about sensors and signal processing. So I'm not going to speak about the sensors specifically. But if you look at basic sensors, are pressure, temperature, so these are the basic sensors that generally we use. It could be pressure sensor, flow. So these are the basic ones that we look at. But if you look at medical specific, then we talk about heart rate. Then we start talking about SpO2 and things like that. However, most of it are still similar. Still, it goes to the basic aspect of it. However, our heart rate and everything these days are optics. So I'll come to that in the next slide. But there is a second way that we can look at sensors or input, okay? And that particular way is by defining the measurement parameters and not defining the sensors. And that is a much more, kind of broader way. And you could actually innovate a lot if you start thinking in that aspect. Rather than thinking from the sensor side, if you start thinking from the measurement side and then get into sensor, you may really have a lot of different perspectives that could come around it. So now how do we look at these measurements from direct and indirect aspects? So I'll get there in the in next two slides. Just give me a moment. So for the first example, let's say sensor, right? So I've just taken a brief thing about an Apple Watch. So people who have used Apple Watch or seen some of the similar watches, you must have seen there are four green LEDs that keep green LED and IR LED that keep glowing onto your watch, and there are some photodiode sensor, right? So now if we see over that, you have just one sensor that is an optical IR based sensor, and based on that they actually look at aspects like heart rate, SpO2 1 2, and then apart from that VO2 max, and there are a lot of other parameters around it. So I'm just taking my watch so that it's easier for me to tell. So at least they look at these aspects. If I take any smartwatch, they look at heart rate, SpO2, sleep, stress. So these are the four healthcare parameters that we can see: heart rate, SpO2, sleep, stress, and VO2 max. VO2 max is basically how much oxygen can you hold when you're doing an activity, right? So these are the health parameters that an Apple Watch or any other smartwatch can look at. And if you look at these aspects, out of all these things that I mentioned, only SpO2 and heart rate are the direct measurements over here, right? So one same sensor can do all these five parameters. And indirect parameters are stress, VO2 max, and even sleep, right? So these are the indirect parameters that they measure using their algorithm. So basically this entire thing is one medical specific sensor. But apart from that, the watch would have your GPS embedded in it. They will have some kind of, gyroscope, accelerometer, etc., so that they can look at walk, all the wellness and fitness parameters, etc., right? So this is how a watch is basically built. And if you look at it, one small watch can give us so many parameters, and that gets into an entire infrastructure, right? So that's the basics of a watch, as I mentioned. And here, if you look at, they chose the sensor, and based on the sensor, you can actually select a lot of parameters, and that's how that was developed. And it was, of course, a couple of years back when things were still working out. So we cannot blame them to do that aspect. Similarly, on the left-hand side, I've brought in the footwear that we are developing. And how we started to look at sensors is, rather than selecting the sensors, we started to see what all are the parameters that actually can give us idea of your nerve conditions, right? So first we looked at those parameters. So if you look at the nervous system, you have two parts. One is your peripheral neurons, peripheral nerves, or the small fibers, which is basically dependent on your cold, heat, vibration, and other kind of sensations. And then you have this large fibers, which basically takes the signal from one point and delivers it to the brain. So there are two parts to it. So if you look at nerve degeneration, the first thing that starts getting affected is the sensors of your body. So the small fibers. In the small fibers, you have C, alpha, and delta fibers. So these are the first fibers which get affected. So out of which, I'm not getting into basics of what happens how, but these fibers are, as I told you, looking at cold, heat, and vibration sensation. So what we thought is, to understand whether your small fibers have started getting affected, what we should first do is, we should first know whether they are responding normally or not. So we decided to include a couple of stimulators within the footwear, which could stimulate heat, cold, and vibration, right? And of course, when we give that, there would be a neuromuscular response. So we thought that, okay, there should be some biofeedback that could actually sense the response to it. So we started looking at myogram and things like that. Not getting into further details around it, but so that's what we started to do. Then we started to look at further parameters, like apart from that, what would happen if you already have a neuropathy or a nerve degeneration? So this things that I mentioned is good if you don't have nerve degeneration and you are looking to have a nerve degeneration in future. Then we started to look what else comes in picture when you have nerve degeneration. And then we figured out that two more important parameters that come in that leads to ulcers, because your body is not able to sense any wound. and that came into pressure and temperature. So those two got added over here, a pressure and temperature. So pressure will tell whether, okay, you're putting too much of pressure in one place. But then we also figured out when we put too much of pressure on one point, when we look at biomechanically our body, we would be adding that stress from the food to some other part of the body. So we figured out, okay, the posture also will change, the way the person walks will change. So we thought, okay, we need to add motion analysis into it so that we could understand how the person is walking, what's happening. At least we get, you know, two data points from both the foot at least. So we had to add foot ulcers. Then, motion analysis, and that would be through an IMU sensor or a gyroscope, as we all know. And then we figured out, okay, all this data, okay, we will get all this data. What would happen to this data? What is the benefit to the patient? Because if we keep collecting the data, the patient may still end up, you know, walking in the wrong way and still injuring himself or herself. That time we figured out we are already using a vibrator stimulus. So why not use that as an actuator also? So such that if they're putting a kind of an high pressure at one particular point, a vibratory feedback is given to the patient, and thereby, you know, they may actually correct their posture. So that got incorporated. So that's how the entire input system was designed systematically for our startup, right? So that's how as I told you, you have two ways to look at. One, select the sensors. Second, you select the parameters and then come back to the sensor. So this is how we work in both the scenarios. And both are valid ways to do it. But then which works better, that you need to really be very, very sure. And thing is, sometimes what happens is when we first select the sensors, we may end up missing out one or two important parameters, and thereby you may have to revisit your design to really change the whole thing, which will put in a lot of time and effort that you have already put. So that's how it goes to input level. So any questions at this point of time from anyone? Okay, so looks like...
Sir, actually the participants, they are not having any control.
Ma'am, now I have changed the setting. They can unmute and they can discuss now.
Okay, sir. So the participants, if you have got any doubt, you can ask now.
Okay, looks like I was very clear, or people didn't understand anything. But yeah, anyways, let me move forward. But if you have any questions, please either send it as a chat message so that one of the organizers can tell me the question, or you can unmute yourself and give the question. Okay, so going forward, so this is what input happens. How do you select your sensor, as I mentioned? And I'm sure yesterday during the session, sensors was discussed in detail. Now comes the second important part, that is process, right? So now when we look at process, it is far more complicated than this, of course. But then these are the four major things or components of a process. One is the controller or processor itself, which is you need to really select what you need, how you need, etc., etc. Right now, for example, if you have a image processing based variable application where there is an image processing happening, then controller may not be enough, because controller has a limited processing speed. It will have limited access to peripherals, etc. So you need a processor. So the choice depends on you, which is better and what is better. So I'll just go back into it in a moment. Then comes, of course, peripherals. So you may ask, if you're using a controllers, what peripherals you are going to add. But today we all know that even if you're using a controller, storage has become a key aspect of it, and the storage becomes a peripheral. And in that storage also, you have multiple aspects that are going in, right, from because of over the air updates and over the air programming that's happening today. You may have a flash memory, you may have some other kind of reserve memory that's going on. Apart from that, you may use SD cards, vibrators. So your peripherals are very, very critical. Or you may have a real-time clock if your controller doesn't have it. So these are the peripherals I was talking about. And you need to select all these things very carefully, because at the end of the day, it's all about computation cost and computation time. If our application is slow enough, it may be rejected. If our application is too complicated, it becomes too expensive and thus rejected. Thereby, your system design has to be very carefully done. And frankly speaking, that's one of the things that's not happening well when we do a project, you know, as a student or as an academic project. Because as an academic project or as a student, we are looking at the output and we don't get into the system design enough. Thereby, when it comes to translation of this project into commercial, right, it becomes a challenge for the companies to really retweak or rework, because the rework means that the whole development time, you know, would be a lot. At the same time, you've already applied for patents, so time is running. So it's very important for an academic institute, be it a student project or be it a research project, if you have a vision to translate the project into product, either you should do all of these things right during the design process of it, or you should involve an industry right at the start of the project, so that there are high probability that the project on successful completion can be translated to product. So that's one of the drawbacks that I've seen across last 5 to 6 years, which is happening, where as a student, we don't see it. And I myself as a student have not seen that, so I can vouch for it. So it's always better that we do these things right in the start of your project. Finally, storage and AI. So I have a whole lot of data to talk about over here. I'm not gonna talk right now about it, but we'll get into it. Communication. So we think communication is all about Bluetooth, Wi-Fi. We use a Wi-Fi certified module or a Bluetooth certified module. It's done, but not true. A lot of things has to be changed in your system if you are using those kind of modules. So we'll briefly look at what are the options and how do we choose those options, but in a better way, right? So that's what we are going to discuss in this particular segment. So to start with, I'll start with a small architecture within the process aspect of it. So we all know about Apple Watch or any smartwatch as such, right? So if you look at Apple Watch and, or any smartwatch, they follow a model view controller architecture. So what does that mean, right? So yeah, ignore this image. It was because of the source that I have taken it from. So if you have two parts, you have your watch part and you have your iPhone/phone part, right? So over here, if you see, your controller and model lies in your phone. So that means the process, the logic, and all of this thing happens in your phone, okay? And in your watch, you have a very small controller, which generally looks at all the visual elements. So processing doesn't really happen in the watch, right? It is only for view purpose, right? So only giving a feedback/display for the people, and in interface is probably there in the watch. But all of this thing, there is a kind of connection happen between the watch and your phone, mostly through your Bluetooth, right? And these both talk to each other every time there is a change. So for example, let's say you want to measure your heart rate, you press something in your watch, one button which measures your heart rate. The communication will be sent to the mobile phone. The mobile phone will tell, okay, start the heart rate sensor or the IR sensor and send me the data. That will be immediately done by the watch, and it keeps on sending the data. And over here, the phone will tell, okay, fine, start displaying this waveform. And the watch continuously displays the waveform. So that's how the discussion happens over here. So in this scenario, what's happened is, your watch will have a very low power controller, and your iPhone already has a high speed processing that's happening, right? So these two keep talking. So this is a model and controller, iPhone, and view is what is your watch, and thereby this becomes a model view controller architecture. So this is one type of architecture that's been right now used. In this, if you see, all the data is stored in your iPhone, and that goes to your iCloud or whatever storage or whatever app you are using over there. And over there, a lot of analytics happens, and everything gets into your system now and then. So that's how this entire architecture works. In a lot of scenario, if you see, this also is a type of IoT, because your watch generally has a SIM card these days, and SIM cards are used for a lot of aspects around it. So that's how this becomes one of the architectures for your IoT to look at. So that's one. Secondly, if you speak, we all know about this, right? We all have heard about it. We all have learned about it. It's basically all the old terminologies coming into a new package. That's all. So one is called as cloud computing, and second is called as distributed computing. And third, these days are hybrid. So which is hybrid between cloud and distribution. So all the 2-3 things that are there, we know. So if you look at in cloud computing, you have all your systems. There is a kind of a central storage or a cloud storage where all these processes happen. The data is sent to this cloud. The cloud does all the analytics. And at the end of the day, all the data is being presented on your laptop or your screen or your mobile phone, right? That's cloud computing. And then comes the distributed computing, where the tasks are distributed across various servers. So if you see your main computer's task is done by a server, the server gives it to a distributed server network. So these are the two ways that we look at it. Now, it's very important for us to understand at this point of time the costing aspect of it, right? We all know about cloud computing. We all know how fast it could be. We all know how scalable it is and blah, blah. But anyone has any idea what is the computation cost involved when you are playing with a lot of data, especially in cloud computing? Any idea? So if we start looking at, you know, backwards, so if our sensors involves a large data set like an image or this thing, you're going to use a lot of internet to send all this data from your source mobile phone / computer to a cloud server. So a lot of data transmission has happened. So there's a cost involved in this transmission. It could be borne by the user or the company. That's a different story. And then in the cloud, you have so much of data. Now, these many data has to be processed using, you know, various cloud, various technologies like Hadoop and so on and so forth, where you will be processing this data, making some sense of this data, right? So a lot of computation is happening in your cloud. And then finally, you push up the result back to your client system. So in all this process, if you look at computation cost, you have three types of cost. One is the transmission cost. Second is the time required in the data transmission, processing, and you send back. Third is the cost of your cloud server itself. See, though Amazon gives you, you know, $1,000 credit or $10,000 credit, if you look at a company, we may end up running out of this credit very soon if we just follow cloud computing blindly and all of this thing happens in cloud. And thereby, what will happen is someone has to bear the cost. And at the end of the day, every time it's the consumer who will be bearing the cost. So the entire cost will come onto your end user for all this process, or else an investor takes the burn out of it. But at the end of the day, from some way or the other way, the consumer is going to pay one way or the other. So that's how the problem with cloud computing is. And these days, I've seen a lot of projects where students telling me that, okay, they work with cloud computing, they are working like this, like that, but then they never understand the cost factor that is involved with cloud computing. And we have used it. We know that running out of $100,000 in a year is very simple if you're using cloud computing. And thereby, so many cloud computing companies are giving you 100,000 credits and etc. So, of course, it's good for prototyping, but at scale, cloud computing may not be a directly good answer, right? Next comes your distributed computing. So distributed computing these days are also called as edge computing to an extent, right? Or edge computing is type of distributed computing where the processes are happening in, you know, various nodes, and then a central server is trying to make sense out of it. This is good. However, the architecture is complex. Any question? Okay. So in distributed computing, basically, you know, you have several nodes which is processing your data, and all this data comes together to make some sense. It would probably reduce the computation cost of a server and utilize the, you know, processing capabilities of your smaller systems, but however, time may still not be kind of saved, and those things are there. So a lot of new things are happening in distributed computing, and thereby I told you about hybrid computing that's coming up. So basically, choosing this right architecture, be it your model view controller architecture, or be it cloud computing architecture or distributed computing architecture, this is very, very critical. And if you look at model view controller architecture, to an extent will have some sort of distributed computing paradigm, but it's not entirely distributed computing. So which one you want to do, you should choose right in the start, because based on those choice, your requirement for controller / processor and other systems will change. So please be very sure right in the start what architecture you're going to use. That's the reason why I was talking about this. So anyone has any questions right now till now about architecture? Okay, probably no questions, so I'll just go forward. So now, once you select the architecture the type of system that you're going to implement in IoT, that is cloud computing based or distributed computing based or model view controller based or any other similar ones, then comes your processor and controller, about how do you select about it or how do you go about it. Now, for example, if you have a signal based application, right, the basically the amount of data that you collect, store and process would be smaller as compared to when you take it as an image scenario, right? However, image also depends on what megapixels or at what resolution that you are taking your image as. That's for sure. But however, all this thing will determine your controller and processor. So you all know about right from 8, 16, 32 to 64 bit, whatever controller processor that you want. I'm not getting into why that bits, and you all know, I'm sure you must be knowing about it. But that is not enough, about the processing power of it, right? So then you need to select your communication also, which is coming in the next slide. But here, when you're selecting a controller, you should be knowing that, are you just going to use a Bluetooth in it or a Wi-Fi in it or both? Or you also have a, kind of SIM card attached to it. So all this decisions will basically kind of, will basically give you an idea of what kind of controller you need. And there's so many type of controllers that are coming today. For example, you have ESP32, which has both Bluetooth and Wi-Fi stack inside the controller itself, thereby communication becoming more seamless, and processing and communication can happen very easily. There are also processors like Atmega processors or controllers, where you just do the control bit of it, and then using your serial communication, send the data to your Wi-Fi / Bluetooth stack, and then goes. So that also is there. So there's so many types. So the one that you will select will depend on all these things, which architecture you are using, how are you going to communicate. Okay, so just don't, kind of get stuck with which controller. Please understand the entire use of your controller and select it wisely, because sometimes we may have an overkill by using a very high-end controller, which may probably need a small, ADC system and not a complete controller as such. So you need to very carefully select which one is there. And if you look at the options that we have today as an IoT, you have right from ESP32 to certain Atmega-based controllers under Arduino brand that has come up. Some particle boards have come up around it. So there are so many options. And the good thing now is India has come up with their own controller and processor system, So if you look at India under the Shakti program, you have both microprocessor, which has been developed by IIT Madras and team, where they have developed a lot of processors, high-end processors, which is made in India, designed in India, and things like that. And similarly, if you look at controllers, there are controllers from CDAC that has come, which is called as Vega series. And these Vega series basically can give you most of it that your Arduino does or all your...
Siddharth. Siddharth, you continue with the available participants. Sort out the problem at our end so that they will join in the next session. You continue with this.
Yeah. I guess you're able to see my screen now. Sorry for the short this thing. So as I was saying, selecting of processor and controllers is very critical, as we know, in any embedded system, right? But here in IoT, especially for medical system, you'll have little more issues around it, right? As I told, regulation is a very key factor when it comes to IoT medical system design. So you need to really closely look, like when you use certain kind of communication, be it the 2.4 gigahertz the near field communication, or the things that you use, RFID or whatever, you need to be very clear that if you want to adapt that into your system, what changes it makes onto your processor and control system, and how can you have a safety around it. And the reason why I'm telling that you should do it in the right in the design stage before even prototyping is because once you go through this entire thing, coming back and again looking at the design is a very, very, very difficult aspect. And thereby you need to be very cautious in selecting your control, right? And I was telling you about the Indian one now. They look promising. Is there any questions, some disturbance, doctors? Dr. Sunny. Okay, sorry for the disturbance. I guess there was some problem from one of the participants. Anyways. So I was telling about the Indian processors and controller. They seem to have done a very good job, but then at this point of time, we don't know when we use them, what all regulatory changes that we will have to make, especially when your product is going to global markets of US, Europe, Australia, so on and so forth. But however, it looks very interesting, and I will say it's a right step towards making our own silicon. So that's something very good that's happened. But yeah, please do explore controllers and don't get stuck with just an Arduino or a TNC or ESP boards. There are a lot more that can be used, and you need to select that very cautiously and right in the design stage before even you go into your prototyping and other things. So that comes into processor. So basically, apart from your number of bits, data bits, I mentioned what all you need to look at it. Secondly, communication and internet. At the end of the day, it's an internet of things. So there has to be data going to the internet, right? So this is where you need to be again very careful, like what's the architecture that you're using. Like for example, if the data is being transferred from your system to your mobile phone and from mobile phone to internet, you'll have to apply different strategies. If you're using a system where directly from your device, the data is going to internet, again, different strategies. Now, let me take both the cases. In case one, like that of Apple Watch or even my system as such, what we are doing is we are collecting this data. Some processing is happening within the system. It goes to mobile phone, further processing happens. And after all this distributed processing, then it goes to the cloud where some more analytics happen and data is being stored and things like that. That's one way. So if you look at it in this way, only thing that we need is either the Bluetooth / Wi-Fi that we are going to select as a communication channel from the system to the mobile phone, right? So that's one way to look at it. So second way, as I was saying, the case two, where the data is directly from your device transferred to internet, then you need to have, one of these three modes. One mode is you have Wi-Fi inside your system itself, right? So basically your Wi-Fi is connecting to a internet gateway and then goes and connects to the cloud. So the classic example of that is Raspberry Pi, which is your single board computer, which has a Wi-Fi where you give all the inputs and you get connected to internet directly. That's a classic case if you see. Next option is you have a GSM within it, right? So basically you have a SIM card based module which connects through either your edge or 4G or 5G communication. So that's another way. Third way is you send a SMS to your server and the data gets transferred. So these are the ways. So now which one to be selected should be chosen right in your design stage, because no point in overkilling, right? Because if you have an extra part of it, it is not going to help your system cost at all. So it's very easy for us to do it in the right first stage rather than making a prototype and then again revisiting the whole thing and thereby changing the whole schema of your system. So be very careful in what you're going to do in your controller. And if these communication peripherals are embedded within your controller slash processor, then nothing like it, because that saves a lot of time and money for us, and a lot of efforts get saved. But if it is not there, then you need to add appropriate ones. So most of the controllers don't have any of these communication peripherals within it, except for the serial communication ports and JTAG ports that are there in your controller already. So be very careful on what you want to do, and both the way works. Now, if you look at an example of an hearing aid, you have like some of these Broadcom chips, which would have the Bluetooth embedded in itself, such that the chip directly communicates to your mobile phone. At the same time, there are hearing aids where there is no communication at all. So selecting that right one is very, very, very critical, right? So that's one of the example of communication and internet. Thirdly, if you look at it, I call it as intelligent of things. I'm not talking about internet of things anymore, because at the end of the day, you have so much of data, and if you are just another data acquisition system, right, it is not going to add value to your entire project that you're working on. That's why I started to call it as an intelligent system, because this data is getting analyzed and there is some action that's happening. So you need to now select your cloud and your processor based on how much data you are projecting to be, you know, kind of acquired, and how much processing is required for those data. So that's very, very, very critical before you choose your processor and your cloud system, and how much processing is required, right? So your model. And now that's where again your architecture comes in picture, like how are you going to do it? That is model view controller architecture, cloud computing architecture or distributed, you need to select that very carefully. Based on that, you will need your processing speed and your cloud storage, and as well as the cloud processing as well. So you have to be very careful how this data flow is happening and where all the processing is happening. So for example, in the footwear that we are developing, the processing is happening in every level. Thereby, we are dividing. Disruption, I covered up the processor part of it, and I told you like how do we select the right one, and the Made in India option also that we have currently. Yeah, ma'am.
You can take your time and complete. So don't bother about the session ending time. You complete your content so that we can even extend the session, the forenoon session.
Okay. Sure, ma'am.
Thank you.
So basically, in the process part, I first spoke about the architecture, that is your model view and controller architecture, where your mobile phone becomes a controller and a model, and your smartwatch or your system becomes a view type of architecture. So that's what is used in Apple Watch and many other wearables that are used currently. And then we spoke about cloud computing and distributed computing and the issues around cloud computing, which we need to think before we implement it. So these are some of the things that we've already looked at. And based on that, I was just talking about how do we select the right processor or controller. And like we spoke about the Shakti processors that IIT Madras has developed and Vega controller that CDAC has developed. And these are now in production, and I believe that in another 3 months it should be commercially available also, and there is some programs around adopting that as well. So it's a step in right direction for sure, but before we select the right processor or controller, we need to be sure about its working and usage. And it's not just about the data bytes or bits anymore, that is 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit, but it's all or your ADC bits, but it's also about, you know, which communication protocol it supports and things like that. So we be very careful, because any change post your prototype will require to rework on the entire cycle, and the regulations has to be kept in the mind in this stage itself. And then, of course, we spoke about communication and internet, where we spoke about these two models. One model was, you know, your system sends data to your mobile phone, and your mobile phone then processes and sends it to a cloud or a remote server. And the second model was your system itself has a Wi-Fi which connects to the internet gateway and goes to the cloud. Thirdly, your system has a GSM which connects to internet through your edge or 4G or 5G communication, and it just goes through. Third is it has a SMS option where there's an SMS sent to the you know, your server, and it gets the data. So any of these modes are possible. Which one you use is very critical in your selection of processor, and based on your application, please choose that, because that would simplify your overall development of the system. And thirdly, I was talking about Intelligent of Things just before we stopped. So if you look at Intelligent of Things, though we tell it as Internet of Things, I call it as Intelligent of Things, because all this data, if it is just acquired and stored in the cloud, is of no use. There has to be some analytics and some intelligence around it so that the model becomes more and more improved. So you need to be very sure how your algorithms work, because you have supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and so many other things that's around it, right? So you need to be very sure what is what, and you need to choose your system accordingly. Now, for example, for the smart footwear that we are developing and we discussed earlier, what I am doing is I am processing it at different places, right? So it's more of an edge computing, where the processes happen within the footwear. It will happen in the mobile phone. It will also happen in the cloud that we are developing. So more following the hybrid architecture rather than just cloud or distributed architecture. So you need to be very, very clear on how you look at it and how easy it will become for scale. The reason why I chose this is because if I just choose cloud computing, my cost will be high and the product will not be sustainable, or it will be rejected by the audience. So that's the reason why you need to think on it well. And your intelligent processing, you need to be very sure how are you connecting it. So that's where you will be doing a lot of innovation these days to make your things/IoT more and more intelligent. How do you really look at it? So that's my whole point. And analytics is the game that we play these days. So yeah, be very sure around this, and this will help you in selecting your right system, at least in the processing layer of this thing. Finally, it comes to output. So output is basically your anything that you want to show. It could be your display, it could be some actuators, it could be anything. Now, for example, in the footwear, there is a vibrator, so there is an output to the process, and vibration helps in giving a feedback to the patient. Now, in that scenario, vibrator is one output. Second, there is a mobile app where you can actually interact with the data. So that's your second output, right? So now if you see here, output itself is distributed. So you need to be very sure how are you playing with all this entire game. And then finally, output at clinical and all other things also come into the footwear architecture as well. So your selection for output and how it will be presented is very critical. And sometimes as an engineer, we forget that, people can't read equations. People just don't understand equations, right? So converting those equations, converting those model data into a, kind of a visualizable and understandable entity is very, very, very critical. And thereby, we need to understand this product experience aspect, which I guess I'm giving another session on Friday, if I'm right, where I will cover all this aspect as well. But then this is the third part, okay. Output, and you need to select that. Hello? Is there a question or something?
No, you can continue.
Sure. Yeah, so basically, that's where the output part of your entire system architecture would come. And please be very careful in selecting your outputs. And because these days you have this touch displays that come into your watch or things like that, which multiplies as your input and output, and thereby you need to handle it differently. So all these decisions that is there in the system design for, you know, medical has to be really, really taken into your design stage, and everything has to look at the regulation aspect of it. And my next two slides are specifically into regulations, so that we understand, though I spoke about the system first and regulation next, because that's how we understand it. The regulatory aspect becomes more and more critical in medical, because at the end of the day, any project that you make in the medical aspect of it has to cross through that regulations, right? And this is again the output part. So you have four types, as I told. One is actuator, second is display, third is the interface, and fourth is the analytics. So you have to be very careful of your outputs, and you know, it has to be readable. And this is where most of our work has to happen, which is not happening in the current day. So that's what I would mention. But as I was speaking about regulation, there are so many aspects into regulation that we need to consider, and so many protocols that we may have to follow. We take it for granted, but when it comes to medical, that's not. Couple of it, yes, it is. Like, for example, Wi-Fi, you can have a Wi-Fi shield and do some changes, and it can be a Wi-Fi enabled system. Bluetooth, same. Ultra wideband is something new. I believe tomorrow Malti ma'am is going to take it, and she is an expert in that area. Then you have RFID, which we all have used. Zigbee's, we all know. But certain things, and FCC we understand probably, but certain things in this that we don't understand is OTA, over the air. So basically, you have seen your mobile phones and your Apple watches having OTA, over the air updates, and you know, all those things. But if the same OTA has to come with medical, the norms becomes a little more strict, okay? And I don't know whether you are aware that most of this software stack of any of these medical devices are not regularly updated, and that main reason why it is because it's tightly controlled by regulations, and thereby you need to be very, very, very careful even in internet of medical things. Unlike your watch or mobile phone, you can't keep pushing updates. There are a lot of rules around that, so you have to be very careful in OTA updates. SAR, we all know about it, so I'm not getting into it, but one of the major issues that comes is EMC, electromagnetic compatibility, and EMI, electromagnetic interference. And why? Because a lot of these patients who will use these wearables may have implants, and will our wearable affect this? Implants are very, very critical to be understood. So if, like, for example, it has an antenna which is giving some electromagnetic radiation, how does that interference happens with the implant? So that's where we need to be very sure in the choice of our entire system design. And that's the reason why these two new words come up in picture, which I'm sure most of us have not heard. One is WMTS, that is Wireless Medical Telemetry Service. So there's a whole regulation around telemetry services nowadays, which in India we have not started to follow, but soon we may have to. So we should understand about WMTS, to go for it. And finally, MICS, that is Medical Implant Communication System. So as I was telling, that how does your wearable actually affect your medical implants has to be looked at it, and how the communication happens with the implant, both has to be considered. And so because, for example, there are pacemakers these days where you can do an OTA, over the air update, or they give you some kind of wireless data. So these follow this protocol of MICS. So you need to understand those also when you're designing a system. So these are certain things that are in addition to all other medical device regulations of electrical safety, biocompatibility, etc. Because it is wireless, biocompatibility comes in picture, which has its own set of rules and regulations that we follow, right? It should the sweating level to all other levels. So these are the other things that we need to consider around our IoT system for medical. And why we need to look at it in the design stage is because based on that, we have to strategize how are you going to use your system, right? For example, let's say if it's a watch-based system, okay? you may have to think about your compatibility, because some allergy to some patients can lead to, you know, adverse scenarios like death. So you need to understand how those things would actually happen and how it has to work. So that's the reason why regulations understanding for a design of an Internet of Medical Things is very, 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 very critical. So these are some new things that I mentioned, but one of the most critical things now coming up is the cybersecurity. So this is something new that's coming up. Though we understand cybersecurity risk for a long time, but it was never under regulations purview until now. But now both European Union as well as FDA is making this as a norm. And even India will follow the follow these norms pretty soon, right? This is over and above the anonymity thing that we are looking at with regards to GDPR, right? So GDPR is a norm again that's coming under cybersecurity, where we are talking about anonymization of data and that data being used for analytics and things like that. So a lot of things around cybersecurity is happening for wearables, which generally when it comes to IoT, we don't consider, but as a systems designer, it's your responsibility to consider these things, because based on that, that's how you're going to send the data to your, you know, kind of system so that you make it as an intelligent system. So it would include right from IT security to information security. It could also look at about your data security layers and you know other issues that around the cybersecurity norms. So this is something new that we need to really start looking into design of Internet of Medical Things. So I guess that should be it from my side. I would love to have some questions if there are any, and then we can probably wind up the session. Yeah, is there any questions? I'm sure like many of you must have not got the initial aspects of it, but I believe there is a recording, so you could go through that if you like. But yeah, mostly I was just talking about how do we have this technical systems in place, and with regulation being one of the key aspects to handle it.
Siddharth?
Yeah, ma'am.
You're able to hear. I have a question. How these wearables will be evaluated or how it will be calibrated? Because we...
Okay, so basically that's where, again, as I was telling, ma'am, system design becomes critical and your application will become critical. So for example, if the wearable is in the wellness zone, then calibration is not a big problem, right? As long as it gives the data, which is plus or minus 10-15% is acceptable. But if the variable is started...
Be connected to simulators?
Yeah, ma'am. When they define it for the use of medicine, then they will be kind of calibrated in the same way as another patient monitoring system would be calibrated as. So it would be connected to simulator and seen like, you know, what is the accuracy levels and things like that. But at this point of time, I am not aware of any variable which has gone through that trigger, because generally it is more into wellness that people have brought in, and thereby it is not. So only Apple Watch has gone through. So they had a whole validation around it, ma'am. So apart from simulator, they were actually given as a your normal along with Holter. Patient used to wear it and then they had to see whether it is a comparable result or not. So those are some of the ways of validating your medical variable as such. Apart from simulators. However, just to add on to this point, unlike your patient monitoring system, which are regularly calibrated in the labs, our variable systems, which are with the consumers, are not regularly calibrated. So that's an unfortunate thing right now, but I believe as we progress, that may also come into picture, and if they are using for medical purpose, hospitals may calibrate regularly and give it to the patient back. So that's another model for calibration based industries around it.
And about a battery issue. So most of the wearables, they come with a battery operated. So are these devices, are the batteries rechargeable, or once for all, once the battery is drained, we have to?
Okay, ma'am, batteries are always rechargeable. Yeah, the batteries are always rechargeable for wearables, ma'am, because so as I told you, right now it's all sensor based wearables, right? So it's using the 100 milliamp kind of a battery range, so very small battery. So they all are rechargeable at this point of time. Secondly, the problem with removable battery in general is these wearables are for the patients. So it becomes an inconvenience, and many times patient may not put the new battery, right? So thereby the whole purpose of wearable may be beaten up. So it's very critical to have that patient experience, considered along with our system design. Though both the ways it will work, but then just to look at the patient experience part of it, it needs to be rechargeable battery right now. And most of the wearables right now are rechargeable battery. In fact, any implants, when you look at it, they also have wireless recharging right now happening.
Siddharth?
Yeah.
Some participants are having doubts. I will unmute them.
Sure. I guess Dr. T. Subhashree, you can ask your question because you have given the mic access.
I hate Siddharth.
Sure.
Yeah. Subhashree ma'am, you can ask your question. We have changed the setting now. You can unmute and ask your doubts.
Sir, am I audible? Sir, am I audible? Sir, since wearable devices, smart wearable devices we are building, for as far as IoT concerned, we have various issues in security issues in IoT, and as far as Cisco can consider the Cisco spec kind of security solutions are already proposed. What are the challenges to be there in wearable devices, sir, for a security point?
So ma'am, when you look at the security aspect of wearables, that's what, as I was telling, the cyber security is becoming a big norm, and at least the Europe's new MDR laws are concerning it, and FDA is also accepting that aspects now. So one of the major security threat is the data breach, of course, that we all know. Given that if there is some other issues around data, that could become a big problem with regards to, you know, a lot of other things that's happening around it. So at this point of time, there are no approved protocols as such, unfortunately. But then it's always good that we follow something around GDPR or something around drafts that are possible at this point of time. And then right now, as I told you, the technology has both the ends, right? So one is the positive and negative. So now at the end of the day, it's about how much risk can we mitigate, right, in this security. So that probably, as every designer of the system, if we start thinking on various threats that can happen, we can start thinking on solution on how to mitigate those threats. So one can be data breach. Second, so probably you can have an enhanced layer of security, which is something very different. So I have something going on in my wearable, but I can't talk right now about it, given that it is yet to be patented and things like that. But again, you can change the way the data representation happens, and you know, you have all those steganography methods, age old, you can improve on that and probably use it. So right now, these are the only ways that you can handle data security for your IOMT as such, Internet of Medical Things. Of course, all the issues that are in IoT comes under with IOMT, but with additional issues of data security. So it's kind of a research area, I would say, right now. And sometimes, like how all other systems have developed, we need to just go with it. And as and when the problem comes in, we need to be very quick in responding to the problem and solving it. So that's how we can right now approach it, unfortunately. However, another 5 to 10 years, we may have a very stable system, but currently it's unstable. You're totally right. And we just need to go about around it. Yeah. I guess there's another question from Dr. RK Kumawat. Okay, so I can see the message by Dr. RK Kumawat. What about the accuracy of wearable and proper medical equipment? So Dr. RK Kumawat, as I told you, it depends on your definition of your wearable system. So if you are looking at a wearable system for just continuous monitoring, okay, and as a preventive system, accuracy is not a big question, because what we are what we need is the trends and not exactly the, you know, quantified values, because it is not being used for treatment right away, right? It is used to just understand the trends. However, if for example the wearable is used for a patient who had a heart attack or some other episodes of a disease, and then we are trying to see how do we prevent it, then in that case, yes, accuracy becomes critical and it will follow the normal norms of medical devices of accuracy that is required as per the diagnostics standards and various other gold standards that are present. But it, again, as I told you, it depends on how do you define your wearable. If it is for wellness and trends, then accuracy is not questioned as long as you have a proper trend that your device gives. I hope I have answered your question. Yeah, is there any other question?
Okay, if there is no question, I think it's the time to wrap up the session. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your expertise on medical IoT design and regulations. Thank you so much, sir. And participants, really very sorry for the inconvenience caused to you all due to the technical issues. We will fix it up and get back soon for the next session in another 5 minutes. Thank you all very much for your patience.
So just before we go up, there's a last question that I can see. Can we use this wearable device in ambient intelligence system? So basically, I'm not very sure on this question, but then it would depend on the utility. So there are two things that generally a system has to think of. One is intended use and another is non-intended use. So please be very sure that any device that is certified only for the intended use that has been described in the system design. For any other unintended use, you may use it, but then you will have to certify it as required. So if you ask about can you use it, yes, no one can stop you from using it, but then it is not certified, please remember that. So you need to look at the intended use of wearable devices very closely. Generally, we don't see that, but that's a very critical aspect. And almost all the regulatory bodies, right from FDA, CE to Indian CDSCO, all of them look at intended use, and the validation and certification happens only for the intended use and no other uses. I hope I've answered that question as well. So thank you so much for it. And one more question I can see. Okay, the question asked, because AML is used in healthcare also nowadays. That doesn't matter, as I told Dr. Kishore, it could be used, but at the end of the day, whenever things are used for medical purpose or healthcare purpose, we have to look at how are they certified and what certification that they have and what was the usage that they have prescribed in that certification. So ambient intelligence system, you may use it, but then you need to see what you are using and why you are using together. So it's a bigger question to answer, and we have to take a specific case to start looking at whether it can be used or not. But in short, answer is both yes and no, as I told you. Okay, perfect. Thanks a lot, team, for inviting me here.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Siddharth. Participants, the technical issue has been resolved. So the next session will start at 11:15. Thank you so much.